camera.
God brings them to mind.
Thank you.
3, page 881 in your handout. Shall we read? I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead.
The Word. which will be shared with us this morning. Lord, we ask that you open up our hearts, open up our minds, open up our spirit, that our spirit may commune in closeness with your spirit, that we may know you even more deeply than we have before. Lord, as we think to you, we naturally think to ourselves. And in our thankfulness to you, we also ask for your indulgence and your blessing in our lives and in those around us. We see names in the bulletin of people who are hurting, people who are ailing, people who are sick, people who are in need, need of your amazing grace, need of your help, need of your leadership, need of your guidance, the need of your comfort, the need of more of your grace. Lord, we thank you that you have made it so that it can be well with each of our souls, and that what you have given us, you give us freely. You gave us Jesus, and you gave us God's riches at Christ's expense. Lord, remind us throughout our service and throughout our week of serving that it is your grace that allows us to commune with you. Now, Lord, we come to you in the prayer that you taught your disciples, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power of God.
Our scripture this morning is Romans chapter 14, verses 1 through 14. And this is the last week I'm going to spend in Romans. We're going to move to Philippians next week. So, this isn't the end of Romans, but this is as far as I'm going to get this time around. Accept him whose faith is weak, without passing judgment on disputable matters. Once a man's faith allows him to eat everything, but another man whose faith is weak eats only vegetables. The man who eats everything must not look down on who does not. The man who does not eat everything must not condemn the man who does. For God has accepted him. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? To his own master he stands or falls, and he will stand, for the Lord is able to make him stand. One man considers one day more sacred than another. Another man considers every day alike. Each should be fully convinced in his own mind. He who regards one day as special does so to the Lord. He who eats meat eats to the Lord, for he gives thanks to God. He who abstains does so to the Lord and gives thanks to God. For none of us lives to himself alone, and none of us dies to himself alone. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. For this very reason, Christ died and returned to life, so that he might be the Lord both of the dead and of the living. You then, why do you judge your brother? Or why do you look down on your brother? For we will all stand before God's judgment seat. It is written, as surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me, every tongue will confess to God. So then each of us will give account of himself to God. Therefore, let us stop passing judgment on one another. Instead, make up your mind not to put any stumbling block or obstacle in your brother's way. As one who is in the Lord Jesus, I am fully convinced that no food is unclean in itself. If anyone regards something as unclean, then for him it is unclean. May God add a blessing to the reading and hearing of God's own word. We went through a vote Monday night that is in your bulletin, that we have decided to start a process to leave the United Methodist Church and become First Methodist Church of Okeechobee, which we were for a long time in the past. There are some from among us who have decided that that was the wrong choice. And we need to keep loving them regardless of their choice. It's interesting that these verses fell this week, right after the vote. Accept him whose faith is weak. Without passing judgment on disputable matters. I hate that we came to the point where we had to make choices about our future that came to the congregation. I had said for years, for the last several years, that I hope we would never come to a vote in the congregation, because votes divide people. It makes people choose. one side or another. And I worried that we would lose people. Well, in the midst of coming to this place, we've lost people. We've lost people through this process. We've got to continue to be the church that loves everyone, that welcomes everyone, that does our best not to get hung up over disputable matters. In this section, Paul is almost certainly talking about food offered to idols. That's something that doesn't relate to us. We don't have a touchstone with that. And so the translators have just focused on the eating of meat or the abstaining from eating of meat. This is not a poke at vegetarians. Although the position Paul comes down to is, if you eat meat, that's fine. If you eat only vegetables, that's fine. And as long as you're doing it to the Lord, there's no problem with it. But each of us has to figure out our own boundaries. When I was diagnosed as a diabetic, I was 21 years ago, the doctor said, if you abstain from, and he had a long list of things that I was to no longer eat or drink. And some of them were like, okay, I'm good with that. And some of them were like, oh, not that. And for 21 full years, I never knowingly ate anything that had added sugar. Now, I have to be real careful. I never kept the full list that the doctor gave me. I still have eaten potatoes, white rice, pizza, a whole slew of things that were on that list. I've still eaten, but I made myself a pathway that said anything with added sugar, I didn't eat. And so I gave up donuts. I gave up cakes and pies. Now, I've learned that they make things that are no sugar added, and they're delicious, at least mostly. Well, this summer, I went off the wagon. We were going to Switzerland. I wanted to have some Swiss chocolate. And they, quite frankly, did not. We never found any sugar-free Swiss chocolate. They just haven't gotten the memo yet. And so I ate half a piece of, well, anyway, I ate Bavarian chocolate cake, which not only has added sugar, but it also has liqueur in it, on it. Black Forest cake, thank you. That's what I ate. I ate a bunch of stuff that was not on that list. But I never saw a donut while we were over there. I would have loved to have had a donut while we were there, but as soon as we got home, I said, okay, I'm back on the wagon. And some of the foods that I had loved, or thought I loved, didn't taste as good anymore after I had been off the wagon. They had some little crackers that I just thought were delicious. They tasted like dust when I got home. My little sugar-free ice cream that I thought was better than regular ice cream. It was was not good at all. And it has taken weeks of abstinence to get back to the point where some of that no sugar added stuff tastes good again. But Paul is using something from current events in his day. There was meat that was offered to idols, and then after it's been used as an offering, meat markets would sell it. Because the idols didn't consume the food. It was offered to them and then taken off the altar and sold to people as meat available for them to consume. And in another place, Paul makes the argument that there are no idols. Their idols aren't real. They aren't something of substance. So if you eat meat offered to idols, it's okay. But to other people, they were like, oh no, you can't eat something that's been offered to an idol. That's wrong. And so that's what Paul's talking about. He wasn't having a carnivore versus a vegetarian debate in this particular place. But it still fits. It reads nicely in our day because we have a lot of people who now abstain from meat or from certain types of meats and others who don't. And Paul says, that's a disputable matter. That's something that doesn't really make a substantive difference. And so don't worry about it. Love people where they are. And just ignore the stuff that divides us. And so he goes into some specific conversation about this. The one who eats does so to the Lord. The one who doesn't eat eats to the Lord. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? We are all servants of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you will, the Holy Spirit as well. And there is no place for us to put someone else down who is also a servant of Christ and of God and the Holy Spirit, who eats those things. It's okay. It doesn't matter. We will all stand before God. And God will sort us out. Then he says, one considers one day more holy than another. There had already begun to arise those who kept the Sabbath. Now, when some of us were growing up, we were kind of taught the Sabbath was Sunday. Sabbath literally means sixth day. It has never been Sunday. It has always been Saturday. And in a Jewish tradition, a new day begins at sundown. When you can see the first three stars in the sky, that's the beginning of a new day. Which is weird to us, because our new day starts at midnight. Which is just strange. I haven't seen the beginning of a new day in quite some time. Not even on New Year's Eve this year or last or the year before. It's it's technically the beginning of a new day at midnight. We're never around for it. So the new day for the Jewish people are when those first three stars appear in the night sky. That's the beginning of a new day. Because the scripture says, and it was evening and it was morning the first day. And it was evening and it was morning the second day. And so evening is the beginning of a new day. But some kept the Sabbath as Jewish tradition. Others began to worship on Sunday as the special day because it's the day of resurrection. It's the first day of the week. Now, you would never know it's the first day of the week. Everyone in our country, and if not the world, thinks Monday is the first day of the week. There are calendars, business calendars in particular, but a lot of calendars are printed with Monday as the first day of the week. And then Saturday and Sunday are a slash day. It's Saturday over Sunday with a hash mark diagonal across it. But Sunday is, was, and always will be the first day of the week. It's because we have set it aside as a sacred day that it's not the first day of the work week. Farmers and ranchers, Sunday was a day that they still had to tend the stock, milk the cows, and all that stuff. And so church got in the habit of meeting at 11 a.m. because it would give the farmers time to do their chores in the morning and still come out, go home, clean up, and come to church. Seventh-day Adventists worship on Saturdays. We worship on Sundays. And Paul says, if one day is more special than another, but you do it to the Lord, it doesn't matter. To another, for whom every day is the same, as long as it's done to the Lord, it doesn't matter. We live in a world where there are lots of other choices available on Sunday morning. There was a time when restaurants and stores and other things were closed on Sunday. And it was designed to try to help people make the right choice. But beaches have always been open on Sunday. And I think golf courses have always been open on Sunday. And nowadays, we have soccer tournaments, swim meets, baseball practice, a whole variety of things that happen on Sunday morning that families have to choose. Am I going to go to church, or am I going to go to this activity and do this thing? People with boats who work are presented with our choices sometimes. Do I go out and fish early in the morning and get cleaned up and come to church? Do I not get to use my boat on Sunday because, you know, it's a sacred day or whatever? All kinds of choices that we have in our world today. There was a time when I thought our competition as a church were the Presbyterians and the Baptists and, you know, the others who were holding church at the same time I was holding church. And I came to realize over time that the competition is not other churches. Our competition is the world of choices that people have on Sunday morning, including standing in pajamas and watching service from home, or turning on the TV and watching any of the myriad of choices of pastors who are on your television, and you have lots of choices. What do we do with our time? What do we do with our day? Each of us must choose. One of the things that came out of COVID, most churches were able to get to the point where they were broadcasting their services. We actually started on my very first Sunday. It's something that grew out of Joy's surgery that she had in our last church, and I tried. The first thing I tried was FaceTiming her. That I would FaceTime her at service, and she was like, "Honey, this feels awkward. I'm the only one watching, and you're like, hi." And so that didn't go over real well. So I found this thing called Facebook Live, and I started putting it on my personal page. And all of a sudden, I had viewers. My cousin started watching. She works at a nursing home on Sundays and works at the reception desk, but she was able to watch me on Sunday morning. And so she's like, "Are you going to keep doing that thing you've been doing the last few weeks?" And I'm like, yeah, we're going to do that. And so we started doing it, and we've evolved. Our technology has improved and improved, and now it's going the other way. But I'm so thankful that if you're tied up, if you're not able to get to the surface, if you're not able to watch while it's on the technology live, that you can tune in later, either to Facebook or to YouTube, and you can watch the service. You're not before back in the day. If you missed, it's one and done. You know, if you didn't see it live, all you could do was hear reports about it. That was a clinker of the sermon this morning. But you didn't get to experience it. You didn't get to see that clinker. Now it's out there for posterity and available, regardless of the day of the week you are able to view it. Every day is holy to the Lord. Whether you celebrate that on a Saturday, or a Sunday, or a Monday, or a Friday, if you do it to the Lord, that day is holy. Not just watching services, but everything we do should be done as to the Lord. If we live to the Lord, says verse 8. If we die to the Lord. That is our calling, to live to the Lord until we die. And then we die to the Lord. None of us know how long we have. So we should live every day for the Lord. Not one day a week, but every day of the week should be a special day, because God has given it to us. And we have the opportunity to praise Him that day, to give Him thanks, and to serve Him in what we do. This is one of those places where I don't fully understand Paul's logic. Verse 9 says, "For this very reason, Christ died and returned to life so that he might be the Lord of both the dead and the living." Christ died that we might be forgiven. He returned to life that we might have life in his name. It works that Christ is both the Lord of the living and of the dead. It's just a little bit of, I guess, odd logic to me. And then verse 10 says, "You then, why do you judge your brother or sister?" It doesn't say sister in our translation, but as I talked about before, when you use the male ending, it is for men and for mixed groups. And I think here's one of the places where he meant it for a mixed group. So why do you judge your brother or sister? Or why do you look down on your brother or sister? For we will all stand before God's judgment seat. None of us should ever look down on anyone. Period. Paul doesn't say, he doesn't offer caveats. Don't look down on a person because of this or that. He does in the beginning, sort of, with his argument about meat versus vegetables, one day versus another day. But now he comes down to a place where he simply says, do not look down on anyone else. For the choices they make, they will stand before God. As surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me, every tongue will confess to God. So then each of you will give an account of himself to God. I wish that those kind of verses were in Scripture. I just like the idea of, you know, you're forgiven and don't worry about anything, just, you know, love God. But there are a number of places in Scripture where it talks about a final judgment that we will have to give an account before God. And when you realize that you've got something that has come between you and God or you and someone else, confess it. Ask forgiveness for that division, for those differences that keep us apart from one another. If we'll focus on love and on loving others, regardless of their political affiliation or their stance on one issue or another, their lifestyle choices, whatever those things are, each of us will give an account to God. And we need to clean those things up in our lives just as soon as we can, so that we can at least say, Lord, I was out of line here at this point in my life, but I forgave. I sought the love. Forgive me. Therefore, let us stop passing judgment on one another. Instead, make up your mind not to put any stumbling block or obstacle in your brother or sister's way. Paul worried about being a stumbling block to others in another place. None of us want to trip anyone else up. None of us want to do anything that hinders anyone from discovering the love of God in Christ Jesus. So we've got to constantly be watching to make sure that we're not doing anything that causes someone else to stumble, that causes someone else to fall. As one who is in the Lord Jesus, I am fully convinced that no food is unclean in itself, but if anyone regards something as unclean, then for him it is unclean. I'm not sure that my little boundaries on food are what Paul was talking about. But he was trying to get us to realize we don't want to do anything that interferes with another person's walk with Christ. May we seek to be faithful. May we seek to be loving in everything we do, in everything we say. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 158, Come Christians, Join to Sing. I would invite you to stand as you're able, and we'll sing together.